Hello, everyone. My name is Brooks Holmes. I'm a band director and professional trumpeter from Massachusetts. I've been playing second trumpet with the New England Brass Quartet since 1993. Over the past 30 years, I've been a band director for middle school and high school students, but for the past 16 years, I've focused on middle school band, and I love it. So today, I'm looking forward to talking about a new passion of mine, which is creating virtual performances. This presentation lasts about 45 minutes. Be sure to check out the Show More section in the video description. I will include all the links and reference materials that will hopefully save you some time and some of your valuable energy. Thanks in advance for joining me in this new virtual presentation world. I hope you enjoy this experience. So let's get started. So the pandemic is not going to stick around too much longer, I hope. Our students will be performing in person again soon. So we won't be dependent on Zoom for our daily rehearsals. So today, let's explore why music educators should include virtual performances as a core element of their curriculum. I hosted my first virtual concert a few months ago through Zoom. I thought it would be a good idea to explain how I had put the whole thing together, because I really wanted the families to appreciate the enormous time and energy that went into getting all of the students together on the computer screen. I also wanted the children to reflect on how they did this whole thing while in this crazy remote learning situation. I was a little nervous about talking too much on Zoom and losing the attention of my audience. So I put together this 2-minute video I'm about to share. I think it did the job pretty well. Here we go. 2, 3. Okay, so I also used that video as kind of a marketing tool to stir up a little bit of excitement and enthusiasm in the days preceding our virtual concert. And that really did seem to do the trick. So if you're going to get started with virtual performances, what do the teachers need to learn? What do the students need to learn? How will you share the products of your work? In regards to the computer hardware and software, What is essential? So what do teachers need to learn to get started? So the rule number one, don't attempt to produce your first virtual performances as something that features your students. I would record yourself and learn how to edit the audio and the video. You don't even have to share it with anyone. Just learn the tricks of the trade here. We all know that if you're working with students, that is not a controlled environment. So, try to work on things on your own a little bit. So you got the treadmill here at the bottom. Before the COVID shutdown, I enjoyed the treadmill at my gym. But for me, exercise at the gym was mostly a maintenance program. My goal wasn't to change my appearance or get ready for a big marathon. It was just always to stay in shape. So one day I realized that was exactly the same mindset I had with practicing my trumpet. I was always just trying to stay in shape, and I never was producing a product that I could have in my hand. Once COVID hit and I wasn't prepping for gigs anymore, I had to totally rethink why and how I was practicing. So I would recommend learning more about the musicians who are sharing on YouTube. I've been teaching and performing for over 30 years, and I felt pretty comfortable in those environments before everything shut down during the pandemic. Thinking about teaching my band students now and organizing them into little boxes on the computer, well, that was way out of my comfort zone. Over the past year, I've watched hundreds of different musicians on YouTube. When I found someone interesting, I subscribed to their channel and I started learning more about them. So you want to figure out, like, how do you put the title page? You know, what are you going to have for the background? You know, there's so many things to think about. So I put together a little compilation video that I'd like to share with you. Of shows you some of the things that I learned while watching some of these band directors. Each one of these videos, like, sometimes you have creative editing, like this guy. So this next little clip that I'm going to play is about this young woman from Australia, and she produces her own self ensembles with her own arrangements, and she's quite a hoot. So I've been watching Maeve's videos over the last couple of years, and she has, you know, improved her in playing, and her she's gotten so much more complex with her arrangements. And she does a video where she explains how she does these videos. And to me, this was a huge, huge help in terms of organizing things so that I could start up with my own students. I'll share a little bit of her video here.
G'day, I'm Maeve from Perth, Western Australia, and if you're here, then I'm guessing you've seen some of my brass videos. I've been getting a lot of questions recently on my arranging and recording process, so this video is to give you a look behind the scenes and show how it's done. On to the next phase, which is the recording. Okay, so you can see me standing here at my desk. I play into a microphone here. That's an SM58. That gets connected to the computer via a USB audio interface, the red box there on the right. I have a pretty basic model. It's a Scarlett 2i2 and it does everything I need. The headphones also get plugged into that, so I've got a metronome click going as I play and I start to hear the parts I've already recorded as the tracks get built up. I start with the tuba line played on the flugel and then move through the other instruments from smallest to largest. That's because with brass, it's a bit easier to adjust your embouchure from a small mouthpiece to a bigger one, but it's very hard to go in the other direction. So here comes the trombone last. You can see it's a bit of a logistical challenge to find room for the slide, but I've got a sit-stand desk which helps. And also a nice big monitor where you can see I'm reading the music and at the same time running the audio editing software. So the sound goes into the computer and arrives into Logic Pro X. Here's the project in Logic. Each instrument is recorded to their own track. So here you can see the tuba. Okay, and with that, let's go on to the filming stage. This is just a quick run through on each of my instruments while the finalised audio track plays in the background through the speakers. As you can see, I've got an audience. That's the next door neighbour.
So I'm not going to play those whole videos for you, and I just kind of cut them up a little bit. But you're going to be able to find those videos in their entirety in my Show More section in this video. So let's go on here to the presentation. So after Google, YouTube is the second most popular search engine these days. And I had just spent so much time trying to figure out how do they do that. So I put together some of my favorite video tutorials for iMovie and Final Cut Pro, both of which are fantastic software programs. I'm a Mac guy, so I pretty much only use Macintosh software. You can do pretty much everything the same using different Windows software, but I'm only going to be able to help you out really on Mac here. So I've included all the links for these different videos here in the presentation notes. Let's see, go back here. All right. So in your next process here, I would recommend experiment making your own videos. It may help you understand the learning process that unfolded for me this past year while I started experimenting with these. So I put together a little video compilation here. And let's see if I can bring this back. Okay. So I started off with just some simple jazz duets so I could learn how to, multi-track. We live very close to UMass Amherst, which has a fantastic music program, and I'm in touch with many of the students there, and they brought this book to my attention of trumpet duets, and I started working on it. Thank you. I really enjoyed practicing those, it totally kind of changed my whole practice routine. So one of the other things I do is I always customize solos for the students when they're in jazz band. And we were working on this piece, and a trumpet player really wanted a solo, so I created this for him. While we've been in remote learning, I find that so many times I'll write out an email and send it to the children, and they're really not into reading the emails anymore. It's just too much. But when I make a video introduction, and I tell them to watch a quick video, they always have some feedback for maybe, and I know that they watched it. Hi guys. So the last recording I shared with you was of some music written by Johann Sebastian Bach. Today, I've prepared a recording of some music written by a contemporary of his, George Philipp Telemann, who back in 1732 composed this music to be performed on harpsichord. I really love studying the music of Telemann and Bach because it's just a great workout with all of its scales and arpeggios and the long phrases that require some consistent air support. All of that is just so important to me as trying to stay in shape as a professional trumpet player. Anyway, I'm thinking of you guys a lot, missing you, and I hope you enjoy my recording, and I really hope I get to see you soon sometime. Take care. Thanks. So learning how to do self-duets and putting two of me on the sofa next to each other, you know, it took a long time to figure out how to do that. And it was fun, but it took a lot of work. And so, but the students really seemed to enjoy it. So then I also used this as an opportunity to introduce different styles of music. And this is a trumpet duet that I was able to add an MP3 background to. So I really had a lot of fun trying to learn how to multi-track and use MP3 backing tracks with that. And I would share these with the students over the past few months, and they seemed to really enjoy it, and it kept inspiring them when they're working on their own solos. A little bit ago, I had to prepare for a virtual performance for, unfortunately, for a funeral, and I used this selection in that funeral, and I'll play just a little bit of it as I started to learn how to use a green screen. So I really started enjoying the challenge of recording with a green screen and trying to share my recordings with friends and family. My mother is a huge Josh Groban fan, so I put together this little video. And it also helped me learn more about the editing techniques required for it. So hopefully watching those videos, you can kind of see the progression that I took, starting off with just simple duets unaccompanied, and then adding some MP3 files, and then trying to experiment using screenshots of the music in the background, and then eventually experimenting with multi-tracking and using the green screen. So I hope that kind of gives you a sense of my journey that I've been on for the past year. And now it would be a good idea to start talking about how I took that journey with the students and their performances. So lots of time and patience was needed to learn recording and editing techniques, using my own videos and my own audio recordings. Then I felt a little bit more comfortable to start taking on student projects. At first, I just would record the students using SmartMusic and then take screenshots of their music and layer them together using iMovie. And so this is one of those examples. Thank you. So that gives you kind of a little sense of the idea. And then I would save that as a quick video and put it on YouTube with an unlisted address and then send it home with the parents. And they really enjoyed that. Another thing we did was put together a little jazz combo. One, two, three, four. So what we would do is the students recorded themselves in different tracks, and we put everything over the bass and the guitar and piano, and that worked out really well. We had a lot of fun with that. This next project was a little collaboration with some of our high school students who joined us for the winter concert. And the students all used music that was assigned to them in their SmartMusic accounts. They recorded the audio and then sent the video in through Google Classroom. So that gives you a little bit of an idea. The students had a lot of fun with this next video. It was a challenge to layer several different videos together, and the MP3 recording of the background music with the students' recordings from SmartMusic. Hopefully that gives you a little bit of an idea of the path that I took with the students, starting with some very simple videos with screenshots of music, and then adding different layers of video and audio and even external audios as well. So I hope this helps you understand the little path I took this past year. Okay, so here's one of those little out-of-the-box ideas. This month, I'm collaborating with three other middle school bands to create a virtual exchange concert. I put together these two arrangements, Blinding Lights and Blues at Frog Bottom, as a way to support the effort and customize it for a virtual concert experience. Now, the students really enjoy listening to things on YouTube as an alternative to just using SmartMusic. So let me open up my Blinding Lights video here. Now, what I wanted to bring to your attention is something that I really found helpful for the students, is once you get all your sheet music put together, save it as a PDF and then import it into your Google Drive, okay? Then you have all of the sheet music easily shared with the students. And you can put all of the band music there, and it's there for the kids to print and use as they like. And this has really been an awful lot of fun. Also, I'll put other videos that I want the students to watch that will support the effort of the lesson. So this song here, I just rearranged and made it for middle school, made it a little bit easier. You can hear a little bit of it. Our idea here is going to let each of the percussion sections have a little solo, and then we'll open that up for a bigger arrangement. Let's see, where are we? I like this part here. So the kids are having a lot of fun with this arrangement. You can access it on my YouTube channel. So the other song that I rearranged for the students is Blues at Frog Bottom from the Standard of Excellence Jazz Method, also found in Smart Music. So what I did here is put the sheet music in this section below. And in for this particular arrangement, I took the big band arrangement and just simplified it with rhythm section and the melody. And then for the solo section, I wrote out four different solos for the students as suggested solos. And then in our classes, we're working on creating their own customized improvised solos. But this really helped springboard the process of creating solos and having that on YouTube so they could listen to it. Really helped out a lot. So let's hear. So I'll go forward so you can hear the solo section, give you an idea on that. Okay, so hopefully that gives you a little sense of how I used the YouTube platform so that we could share our music and give the students an alternative to Smart Music for their practicing. So what do students need in order to record and submit their videos? Well, they're going to need a laptop, Smart Music subscription, and some platform that the teacher can use to receive the videos from the students. And of course, the platform for the students to send the videos to the teacher. Okay. If a student only can use a Chromebook as their one device, then you're going to need to show the students how to split screen on the Chromebook, and you're going to need to be able to change microphone settings so that they get a good recording. I'm sure everybody already knows how to do this, but hopefully having these quick links will help you. Now, if a student has access to two devices, a computer and an iPhone or a tablet, then you're going to need to give them some directions on how to submit their recording as well. So I've put together a quick information packet here that helps the students follow step by step on what to do with their recordings. That seems to help out an awful lot. You can get that in the show more section. And make sure that if a parent does email you, that you use the zip extractor when trying to download. So once you have created your virtual performance, how are you going to share the product? I totally recommend that you create a YouTube channel. There's so many different videos out there about this. It's important because you need something where you can store and share your video. Just remember, you don't always have to make it a public video. You can use a private or an unlisted listing, and it works out really well. There's a couple videos here that I've included in the links for you guys.
This video, I'm going to walk you through how to create a YouTube channel.
There's some great ones out there, but I found these to be very helpful. This guy is fantastic.
Oh no, how do I send a video in an email? Do I have to attach it? Do I have to upload it to Google Drive?
So have some fun and watch that. I think that you'll find that to be quite helpful. Now, when you're posting your videos, if it's for students, then label it this way. It's very simple to do in the posting procedures here, and it will look like this when you're posting them. I would recommend creating a playlist on your YouTube channel that's only for student videos. I often will put these videos onto a special page that's on my teacher website. And here's that teacher website for you. And when we do something like for a virtual band concert, all the recordings are here in the concert order for the students and their families to review. Most of these are usually unlisted. So the only way that they can be viewed is by going onto our website. And that's one way that we can control things for keeping the privacy of the students and all of that. I have posted the address for my teacher's website in the handout that will go with this video. So one of the other things that I would recommend is that you create a consistent email footer so that when you send out documents, you're able to market your program and make it easier for everyone to find your website and your virtual concerts and performances and all of that. The more visibility that you have for yourself and for your students, it's going to make it easier for your recruitment and increase your retention rates. Remember that website I spoke about, well, I always have a link for these in my emails. I try to make it easy for the students so that they really only have to click once or twice to get to things. So having the showcase for student learning linked to my emails, the students are more apt to visit it and check on their recordings. And you know, they really get pretty excited to have their stuff here. Like I said, sometimes it's just a simple recording with from SmartMusic with screenshots of the music overlaid. And sometimes the music's a little bit more intricate. Kids have shot videos at home and we've combined them into more elaborate videos. But most of these are unlisted and only viewable by the students and their families when they go onto my website. So hopefully that gives you just one more idea about things. So as we're going into the home stretch here, you're going to want to know what's the essential hardware that you need in order to get started. I'm not going to go through each of these, but I'll tell you that they are all listed in the information section attached to this video. When you start with videos, you're going to be amazed at how quickly the hard drive space in your computer gets used up. You're going to need an external hard drive. I would really recommend the Lacy portable one. It's really fast. You don't even know you're using an external. You're going to need some type of a audio interface so that you can connect microphones. So of course, and if you're using an iPad or anything, you're going to need certain dongles to get things going. But I've included this so that you can browse these at your own leisure. you're going to want to know the essential software. I said before that I'm a Mac guy, so everything that I'm always doing is with Macintosh computers, so I'm sorry about not being able to give you hints for Windows applications, but if you Google the equivalents, they'll come up really quickly. Highly recommend using SmartMusic so that you can coordinate the recordings really easily and give the kids tons of literature. My number one recommendation, if you're on a Macintosh, get the Pro Apps bundle for education. It has Final Cut Pro, Logic Pro. There's like four other softwares in there that I haven't got around to using yet. But it has a combined cost of $199 for the bundle. You have to kind of search for it. So I did leave you the link here. If you just look for Final Cut, you can pay like $600 or $700 for it. You don't want to do that. Yes, GarageBand and iMovie will work to get you started. But once you get going, you're going to find out that you're really going to want Final Cut and Logic Pro. Converting YouTube clips into MP3 is a essential tool so that you can create backing tracks for your recordings. And being able to download YouTube videos and then be able to make your own videos out of them by cutting and splicing and all of that is really great. So you're going to want that website. And sometimes you just want to take little clips of YouTube videos and you don't want the entire YouTube video. Convert just clips is an excellent, excellent resource. So really, guys, thank you very much for being with me today and sticking around to the end of this presentation. I hope that I've given you some ideas that I'm going to save you some time and some of your valuable energy. If you have any questions, my contact information is in the video links. And I wish you all the best of luck with this. It's a new age of teaching and performing and sharing our music. And in some ways, it's very exciting. Thank you very much for joining me. Bye-bye.